So we're moving into our second lecture in chapter 5, so we're continuing in on chapter 5. The most important stuff is already covered in chapter 5, okay? That was the lumped capacitance method. You cannot, should not, leave this class without mastering that. You should be able to justify it, checking what they call the BO number, some H, L sub C divided by K. If that's small, what's small? Less than, much less than 1. Well, what's much less than 1? Less than about 1/6 is the recommendation or the value out of the textbook, okay? And then once you can do that, then it's a lumped capacitance. It's analogous to a capacitor, an electrical circuit with a resistor, an electrical circuit, and you discharge the capacitor through the resistor. The same mathematics. Talk about the concept of the time constant. You talk about the exponential function, etc. Okay, but now we're going to move into this section, spatial effects. Talk about a wall exposed to convection or a cylinder or a sphere, a long cylinder or a sphere exposed to convection. This section is very much mathematical. It's very mathematical. Super mathematical. Sometimes I think this course is hard, not from the concepts, but from the math. So I used to be much more enthralled with the math, love to cover the math, love to test the students on the math, but over the years, I've shifted a little bit away from it, and I've actually spent more time in computational approach. Remember the last chapter? I think you finished up the homework in chapter 4, and those were finite difference type of numerical solution. And I'm going to try and cover that as well in the end of chapter 5. In what you have to do is you have to give something out of the course in order to emphasize something else. So I'm going to give you a quick lecture on the math here today. It's very mathematical, but also I can't afford to reteach Engineering Analysis 1 or Engineering Analysis 2. Both of those classes are required classes. Both of them, I can point to sections of the textbook, either Kreisig or Green or whatever textbook you took for those classes, and I can show you that's where you mastered this concept, and I can't afford to recover it as if you never saw it before. So there's an explanation. Encourage you to really strive to follow the lecture and to master the material. Let's jump into it. We have a plane wall. So we're just solving for temperature in this plane wall as a function of location x, there's our coordinate system, and time t, because it's transient. So we're looking for temperature as a function of location and time. And this wall has the x coordinate running from the center line at 0 out plus L and minus L. That's consistent. So L is the half thickness. And we have convection on both sides, both faces. So it's shown in 3D to try and get the orientation in 3D. We're going to start with the wall is uniform at a high temperature. So maybe you think about using this y-axis and talk about the temperature. And so it's uniform high temperature T initial. And then it's exposed to the fluid, which is a lower temperature. Let's kind of put it out here. So that's our fluid temperature. And so there's some temperature variation in the fluid. That's not the point of interest of this chapter. It's the temperature variation as it starts to cool inside the object. And so the object can be like, here's a temperature profile after a second or two, etc. So hopefully this makes more sense now. What are we focusing? Only on 2D, just a projection of that 3D problem. We're going to help, again, our coordinate system is x going from negative L to plus L, covers 0. And this is the temperature initial. So at any location, x is between negative L and plus L. At time equal to 0, the temperature is a value T initial. But then maybe this is at a different time. Maybe this is the profile at time equal to 5 seconds later. And maybe this is the profile at time equal to 50 seconds later. And maybe this is the profile at 500 seconds later. I'm just throwing out some values to help you visualize it. And you can see that we have different temperature. Where is it the hottest in the material at 5 seconds? It's at the center line, right in the middle, where x is equal to 0. That's the hottest. But it's colder out at the edge. But it's for this plot, the temperature at the surface, right here, is not that much colder than the temperature in the middle, right? But this would be the temperature at x equal to L at that time of 5 seconds, the surface temperature. Now, at 50 seconds, is the surface temperature the same as what it was at 5 seconds? No, it's lower. And so is the centerline temperature. And so they're showing you as your time goes on how the profile changes. Okay, makes sense on this? Very good. I have some questions for you. A clicker question, if you have your clickers ready. So here's my clicker question. What is the temperature at x equal to 0, comma, t equal to 0? So position 0, time 0, equal to, is it either equal to 0, ti, t infinity, or cannot be determined? All right, let's take a look at the results. And we are 95% there, 94% there. So what it is at the x equal to 0, what is that? That's at the center line. Time equal to 0, that's the initial. It starts initially uniform temperature. So it starts everywhere at T initial. Next clicker question. I'll let you read it and answer. Yeah, this is my rendition of T infinity, which the book puts like this, but I don't have the ability to make it look good. All right, so we take a look at the responses and T infinity. So I know this is hard, but time much, much greater than 1 would be like time goes to infinity. It just, at the end of the, after a long, long, long time, after a long, long, long time, right, you're down here and it's just going to be flat across, and the temperature at the middle is equal to the fluid temperature, T infinity. So there you go. Well, now we take a look at three different cases following the textbook. This is straight out of the textbook, but I've taught it enough times that I need to go slow here and help you understand it. We have case A and B and C. Well, we just spent some time looking at case A. What's really, in your own words, the difference between case A and the most severe case C? What's the difference? How about if I let you talk about it, I'll go around and collect a few answers. Well, there's a number of ways to answer this question, isn't there? And basically, if you looked at the centermost, let's say at this particular time, let's say this time and that time are about the same. I'm just using it as an example. At 5 seconds, at 5 seconds, right? Then you would say, what's the difference between the innermost temperature in case A versus the surface temperature in case A? That temperature difference isn't very big. It's like the object is fairly isothermal. And then over here, the centermost versus the surface temperature, oh, in case C, there's a big difference, isn't there? Meaning that that object is not isothermal. So that's a good way to explain it. Some people even went further, and they talked about, well, I know what would make the temperature distribution look more like C than A, and they related it to a property K, right? What did they say about the thermal conductivity of the material for case C? Is it high K or low K? Low K. It's some sort of resistance to heat transfer and conduction within it. It's not a very good conductor. So this one is a high value of K. Some people could have also talked about H. H on the outside. Remember, we have convection on the outside. And some people maybe say, oh, the H for case C. How do we compare the convection coefficient? Let's say that the thickness is the same, the conductivity is the same, but somehow I just changed H between case A and C. Which one has a high H, the convection coefficient, case C or case A? Let me walk around and get an answer from each of you.
Professor, I came here to listen to a lecture. I came here to listen to a lecture.
So playing this concept game, I think most of us would say that the H for case C would be greater than the H for case A. It's just like it's able to convectively cool the solid off the surface easier for the third case, case C, than the first case, case A. Does that make sense? So it's like dropping that surface temperature and bringing it down as you're convectively cooling it. Maybe an easier question, let's say you're blowing fluid on the outside. Which fluid would give you a higher H? Let's say you had the choice of putting either a gas blowing it over or a liquid blowing over to make the convective cooling. Do you think the KC would be the gas or the liquid?
The liquid,
you're right. Yeah, all right. Now let's go to some clicker questions. Which case has the highest H? Oh, come on. I ask my own questions and then answer them. Oh, no, that's too easy. Aha! Which case has the smallest BO number? And by memory, the BO number is, BO number is H L sub C over K. No, it is a clicker. All right, so if the BO number is much, much less than 1, then it justifies the use of what approximate method? If the BO number is small, what method? The lumped capacitance method. And so what does the lumped capacitance method really say in terms of temperature distribution? That would mean that the temperature change that's in the conduction inside the material moving from the interior to the edge is small compared to the temperature change from moving from the edge or the surface into the fluid, the convective temperature difference. So which case A has the temperature difference between the interior at any instant in time and the surface is small for case A? The case A has the lump capacitance is justified. Case A is small BO number. So let's take a look at our grades. Hey, that's pretty good. Yeah. All right. Oh, no, this never ends. Do you want to continue? Yes. Which case is lumped capacitance model justified? Oh, come on. But I just said. A. Okay. Now we go to this one. Which case has the greatest Fourier number? And by reminder, the Fourier number is alpha t divided by L squared. What is alpha again? The name of alpha? Thermal conductivity or diffusivity? Alpha. Diffusivity, thermal diffusivity. Just another property of the material. It's defined as the ratio of K divided by rho C. It's just a property of the material. Okay, let's open that one up. Okay, so what was this Fourier number? Think of it as a dimensionless space or a dimensionless time. What is a Fourier number? Dimensionless space or dimensionless time? Time. It's time. Okay. So what did each of these different curves represent? Different times, true? And so as you go on and on in time, that's usually how they say, oh, that's increasing time. Or over here they say increasing time, okay? Then you're getting different profiles. But there's nothing to really tell us that this was 5 seconds, 5 seconds, 5 seconds. This one's 50 seconds, 50 seconds, 50 seconds. This one's 1 hour, 1 hour, 1 hour, anything like that. It's all qualitative. But for all three cases, that's a direction of increasing time. And we know that as the Fourier number goes off to infinity, as time goes off to infinity, what does the temperature profile look like? Kind of a boring flat line, the fluid and the solid at every point all have the same temperature, T infinity. So this question, we're going to re-ask.
I didn't grade it.
So I'm going to show you everybody's responses as we go. And I'm going to tell you A is not the correct answer. So get away from A. Yeah, go for E, like I don't know. All right, we're locked in. Really, this is one of those bad questions, isn't it? There's really nothing. I just had to, after all these other easy questions, I just had to throw a challenging question in there. Sorry. So it's D. I guess we should also give that person credit. Or these, and everybody but that person. Did you put the... All right, so now I'm going to pause. I'm going to walk around. What I want you to do is write down the differential equation used to solve for the temperature as a function of position and time. Because this section is very highly mathematical. But can you even, where's the starting point? Can you write down the differential equation? Or are you going to have to consult the textbook and stuff? From memory, what can you do? How close can you get?
It's a differential equation we're going to solve. We're going to solve it.
So let me go ahead and say that we covered something in chapter 2. And it was something like, oh, there's del squared t. What's that? Laplacian. And then you had the k, then you had, I don't know, q dot, then you had a rho c partial t with respect to time. Something like this. Do you remember anything like this?
Yeah.
And then for this problem, did we talk about any q dot in this slab? No. Throw that term. We love to throw terms out, don't we? And then we like to say, look at this Laplacian, I can write it in three-dimensional Cartesian, I can write it in three-dimensional cylindrical and three-dimensional, but really just for this problem, it's just 1D rectangular. 1D rectangular, doesn't it just come down to the second derivative of temperature with respect to space? Isn't that the Laplacian? And then we have the rho C partial of T with respect to time. Yeah, that's it. Now, really, and you boil this down, heat transfer is simple. Conductive heat transfer is simple compared to dynamics. There's no inertia analogy. In dynamics, you would have something like that. You would get a second time derivative. But not in this class. It's easy. It's just the first time derivative. So it's a lot easier. Now, the other thing is sometimes they'll put the second derivative of temperature with respect to space. They'll put 1 over alpha partial of t with respect to time. It's getting a little more abstract because they put the k over there, and then it's alpha is defined. But it's the same equation. Now, that's my governing equation. It is second order. The highest space derivative is 2. Second order in space. 2 space derivatives. And it's first order in time. So how many boundary conditions do you think you need for this problem?
2.
And how many initial conditions that's linked with time? And you have only 1 time derivative. How many initial conditions do you need? 1. So now we know that x goes all the way between negative L and plus L. But isn't it symmetric about the x equal to 0 axis? So let's do this. Let's get a boundary condition at x equal to 0. And then after we get that one, we'll work on the appropriate boundary condition at x equal to L. So two boundary conditions, one coming from the requirement or restriction on what's happening at x equal to 0. Write that down, and then we'll move to the harder one, what's happening at x equal to L. All right, so we'll pick it up here. When you think about symmetry, isn't it like thermally well insulated? Isn't it like the flux Q double prime at x equal to 0 is equal to 0. There's no flow, well insulated. From Fourier's law, Q double prime is negative k dt dx at x equal to 0 is equal to 0 because it's well insulated. Can I get rid of the negative sign? Multiply both sides by negative 1. Multiply both sides by 1 over k. And lo and behold, the bottom line is at any time, at all time, the temperature profile, the slope of the temperature profile is flat, or it's 0 right there. It's like slope 0, 0, 0. Symmetrical. There you go. Is that a good boundary condition? Yeah. Now, what about the boundary condition out here at x equal to L? Put a little CV. What does the CV stand for? Control volume. Something's leaving out of the left of the control volume. Something's entering. Oops, I'm leaving out of the right. Entering on the left side of the control volume, right? What would be coming in on the left side? Q double prime from the conduction. What's going out? Q double prime. Convection. The way we've written it, you'd put minus k, the partial of t with respect to x. This really should be a partial. Sorry, I put an ordinary derivative, partial derivative. At x equal to L, is equal to my equation for the rate of heat transfer, the flux, would be h t at the surface, which is at L, comma, any future time, at any time. X is equal to L at any time t minus t infinity. Does that make sense? Now you can clean this up a little bit, okay? And we would, but you can see that it has both h and k in it. Okay, the last one. What is the appropriate initial condition? What do you mean initial condition? Well, when does the simulation start? When time is equal to 0. Is that when it's initial? Yeah, that's your initial condition. So what is a good initial condition? Well, it's given right here. It's temperature at any location x, comma, at time equal to 0 is equal to a constant, which is t initial. So now that we have the initial condition, a boundary condition, a governing differential equation, we just turn the students loose and let them solve. That works, yeah. But before I do that, let's talk about a clicker question. What is the boundary condition at x equal to L, x equal to 0? Which one of those, A, B, C, D, or none of the above? So, yeah, it's C, it's this one. It's like well insulated, symmetry boundary condition, x equal to 0. The temperature profile is flat right there at any future time. All right, last one. What is the boundary condition at x equal to L at the surface? Okay, you're right. This is the right one. So it's expression of Q double prime conduction at coming in to the surface from the solid is Q double prime going off into the fluid. A conservation of energy statement for a thin control volume at the surface. Well, we have now a well-posed problem mathematically, a governing PDE, partial differential equation. Two boundary conditions, one initial condition. Let me have at it, Professor. Well, I'm going to give you the solution in one slide. Here it is. So what do we do first of all? This is a summary of the differential equation, initial condition, boundary conditions. We introduce theta. We have a theta initial and theta asterisk or theta hat. I use theta hat. The book uses theta asterisk, which is basically a dimensionless temperature difference ratio. Okay. And then we have dimensionless, I think book uses x star or asterisk, and then t asterisk, which is simply the Fourier number. So we have dimensionless temperature difference ratio, space, and then time. Then it transforms this differential equation to there, this initial condition, boundary condition, and boundary condition. Notice that we pick up a BO number. That's our dimensionless parameter, BO number. Now, there is a lot of WORK from the bottom here to the top here. It's a method of a product. You assume that the solution is a form of the product of terms, so that it's separable into a function of space times a function of time. And then you find out that you have a bunch of space functions and a bunch of time functions. And it's an infinite series, so summing from 1 to infinity. The spatial effect is wrapped up in this cosine term, and the time effect is wrapped up in the exponential. It's actually pretty simple compared to the dynamics problems that you see in your dynamics and vibrations classes. The coefficient C and the parameter zeta need to be calculated. Okay, the C looks pretty interesting. If you give me zeta, I can get C, no problem. But the zeta equation is the tough one. It's a very, very tough problem. You solve for multiple roots of this equation. And so that's why you have zeta 1, zeta 2, zeta 3, and they just leave it as zeta n. So each one of those work in this equation. And the first four roots are in appendix B3. So this is, again, that equation being repeated, zeta n times the tangent of that zeta n equal to BO number. So it's a function of the BO number, and then the first, second, third, and fourth. This is more information than most heat transfer textbooks give you. So if you found, oh, well, here's my BO number, here's my first, second, third, and fourth, then what you would do is you would go back and get the C's, C1, C2, C3, C4, and then you would have a summation of up to the first four terms in the solution, analytic solution for the temperature. Now, if you have a Fourier number greater than 0.2, and this is almost always on an exam for a class like this, because you don't have time to do four terms and summations, but you have time if you learned heat transfer, or at least the mathematics behind heat transfer. You may have never learned heat transfer, but some students do good at learning the mathematics behind it. Then the first term survives and the rest are negligible. So, big hint, right? When you can justify it, when you can't have lumped capacitance, but you have a Fourier number greater than 0.2, then this is the first term, just C1, zeta 1, and zeta 1. You see that. It boils it down. And then notice a lot of times they're interested not in the distribution through the solid. They're either interested in the surface or the center line. If it's at the center line, what's the cosine of 0? Cosine of 0 is 1. And so you can get a simpler solution for the transient temperature profile for this complicated problem at the center line. There it is. And it's exponential. So this is very useful, and I would say on a lot of exams that test students in this section of the class. So table 5.1 gives you zeta 1 and C1 for the plane wall. So you don't even need that equation to get C1. If you know zeta 1, here's C1. For a whole range, I cut right in here, and a whole range of BO numbers. So you could just say, okay, I calculated a BO number. I have to go get the zeta 1 and C1 and then use it in that equation. They also do it for an infinite cylinder and a sphere. The differential equation for the infinite cylinder and the sphere look very similar to for the wall. I didn't repeat them, but it changes the Laplacian, and you have to play with the boundary conditions, but they're there. Okay, but look, whenever you have a little footnote right here, like this is the BO number, go down and look at A footnote. Here's the A footnote. It says the BO number is HL over K for a plane wall. I got it. I know it. Okay, no problem. But then it's also equal to HR naught divided by K for infinite cylinder, or BO number is HR naught divided by K for a sphere. What is R naught? It's the outer radius. But you're going to, you calculate L sub C to check for the BO number, and you use that in the length scale to see if it's much, much less than 1 to justify lumped capacitance. So at this point, I encourage you to pay attention, because when you're using the BO number to justify lumped capacitance, you use R over 2 or R not over 2 for the cylinder, or you use R not over 3 for the sphere. That's your appropriate characteristic length, L sub C. That's a volume to area ratio. But you can't justify, the BO number is not small enough, you can't justify lumped capacitance. You're going to use the full solution, but maybe you only need the first term because it's a Fourier number is greater than 0.2. So you're going to come in here. You have to not use, you can't say that, oh, this BO number that I'm using in table 5.1 is the same. It's the same for the plane wall, but not for the cylinder or sphere. It's off by a factor of 2 or a factor of 3. So don't fall into that trap. Okay? All right. Let's solve this problem. I have it all worked out, so maybe we can go a little faster. We have a solid 3-centimeter diameter sphere. Right away, it's a sphere. And it's made of glass, where the glass properties are down here. Now, I solved this problem in the previous lecture where this 3-centimeter diameter sphere was made of copper. But now it's made of glass. What's the big difference between copper and glass? Look at the K. It's a lot different. The glass is not good conducting compared to the copper. Last time, the copper, we justified lumped capacitance. This time, with the glass, nope. I can tell you, that's why we picked glass. So, we have the same high temperature coming out, initially all at 80. You expose it to air at the same temperature and convection coefficient, and then you ask the same question, how long does it take for the center of the sphere to cool to 50? The first thing you do is see, if I can use lumped capacitance, I want to use it. I need to check it. So you calculate your BO number using the characteristic length. The characteristic length is the radius divided by 3 for a sphere. And you find that it's 0.268. What do you think? Is that a lot less than 1? Nope, not justified. So now you back up and you don't use the lumped capacitance. And you say, I still want to find where the dimensionless temperature difference evaluated at the center is. 50 minus 20, 80 minus 20, it's a half, okay? So I'm going to use this approximation. I'm going to assume that the Fourier number is greater than 0.2. I'm going to then use the one-term solution. Here is the one-term solution for the center line. Remember, the cosine is 0, or cosine of blah, blah, blah is at 1. I reevaluate my BO number, but this time I don't use the characteristic length. I use the actual radius of the sphere. The difference between this one and that one is only a factor of 3. But how many students will take this same BO number, not multiply it by 3, and look up in the table 5, whatever it was, table 5.1, to get the zeta and C1? Don't do it. That's what I'm warning you against, okay? So what it'll do is you'll just look it up at 0.268 instead of 0.8036. And when you come into the table, yes, please do some interpolation. You're seniors, you're graduating soon. I don't need to explain it to you. Just do the interpolation for the sphere to get the zeta and C1. It'll come in just like this. There's our values for this problem. All right? I like to work out, it's 3.6% of the way from the first to the second value. I like to work it out that way. Okay, so I have these two out of the table. I want to solve for the Fourier number. Use this equation. Solve for the Fourier number. Fourier number is natural log theta hat divided by C1 minus 1 over zeta 1 squared. You plug in the numbers and it comes in at 0.435. At this point, you check to see if it truly is greater than 0.2. If it's not, you need to go with more terms. Maybe use the 4 terms. Okay? And then, but that's going to be mathematically onerous. It's going to be challenging to use four terms and do the same thing. But here, since it's this, you confirm that the assumption that it was Fourier number greater than 0.2 is good. So you're happy. So now you unravel the Fourier number to calculate the actual physical time. Remember, Fourier number is just the dimensionless time, and you calculate 131 seconds. Somebody says, what happens if I would have used the lumped capacitance method? You would have calculated the answer to be 87 seconds. Are they consistent? Not really. Maybe you say, well, this is good to one significant digit of 100 seconds, and this is good to 100 seconds, hence they're pretty good. Well, okay, if your tolerance is that high for error and approximation, then it is okay. But most of the time, we want it two significant digits, if not more. Okay? And since we're studying this highly mathematical section, the heat conduction, we can get three significant digits to our answer. This is reported to three. The book does a good job of this. The total energy transferred out of the slab. This is one of those times where they used cap Q. Rare in this class. Remember, cap Q was used a lot in thermo one, but it's very consistent. It's how much heat was, or energy, how much heat was transferred out of it. How much can be possibly transferred out from the initial condition? Well, it all starts at Ti, and it all is going to go to T infinity. You tell me how big it is, and the mass and specific heat, and I'll tell you the maximum amount of energy that can will eventually be transferred out. But then you say, well, at any particular time, if you give me the actual temperature profile compared to the initial temperature profile, I'll do that temperature difference integrated, and this will be the actual amount transferred out. So this Q will always be less than Q naught. You can put a ratio, Q over Q naught goes from 0 to 100%. And they do that for the, as long as you, it's a Fourier number is greater than 0.2, the first term survives. And this ratio, how much fraction has come out for the slab, they do the same thing for the cylinder and the same thing for the sphere. And at this point, I just want to point out this cylinder, okay? Take a look. What is this J? You ever been to an extended family reunion where they got second and third cousins and somebody says, oh, I know you. Like, really? I've never seen you, heard from you, nothing. Well, anyway, this is your old second cousin once removed, the Bessel function, your intimate friend from previous classes. I don't remember that class. I don't remember that function. Well, okay, it's just like a family reunion. Neither do I. But mathematically, deep in the bowels of many textbooks is the Bessel function. I've exposed it to you. I'm teaching you heat transfer or math. Which one is it? I don't know. But anyway, you could take a look. That's why I really don't cover these sections like this. It's beyond the scope of what really needs to be covered in undergrad introduction heat transfer textbook. And I'd rather move to radiation. We are not going to we're going to cover radiation because it's very important. So less time on this heavily mathematical section of transient conduction. But I think we have enough time for a problem. We have a plain wall. It has a 50 millimeter thickness, and it's initially uniform temperature at 0 degrees C. So T initial is 0 degrees C. It's cold initially. It's well insulated on one face. Put that at the X equal to zero. And it's suddenly exposed to a fluid that's hot, T infinity is equal to 60 degrees C, with the high convection coefficient of 500 watts per meter squared degree C. All right. The wall has properties. You can get the rho, the mass density, the specific heat. You can get the thermal conductivity given. Thermal conductivity is right there. Look at the value of thermal conductivity. Looks like it's a metal, steel. Okay. Not copper, not aluminum, and not low. It's a good steel. Okay, and then if you do the ratio K over rho C, here's the value of alpha, and it's consistent. Okay. Calculate the surface temperature at a time of 500 seconds. What is the temperature right there? T at x equal to L at time equal to 500 seconds. Reasonable request, true? All right, what's the strategy that you're gonna employ? Should I pause and walk around, let you think about it? All right, so the way you start any of these transient conduction problems is you try to see if lumped capacitance is valid. And if it is, you want to use it. It's much simpler. To test it, you want to calculate the BO number, which is HL characteristic divided by K. In this case, the L characteristic is the full thickness because one side is insulated. So we put in our H value, which was 500. I'm going to drop the units, but the units you should make sure they work here. And the thickness, L 0.050, and then you divide by the thermal conductivity, what is that, 63.9. When you run that, what did we get?
0.394.
Let me see a few thumbs up if you get that number. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yes, we have over 10 confirmations, thank you. So that's the BO number. Now we make a decision. The BO number is much, much less than one, yes or no? No, we have to go with the full solution. Now the full solution, you can do an infinite series solution and they give you the first four terms, but I'm telling you, you need to basically have the Fourier number greater than 0.2. Then it's a one term, not an infinite series, just one term solution. Can you actually calculate the Fourier number at this point? It's alpha T divided by L squared. So alpha is given 18.8 times 10 to the minus 6. The time is 500 seconds and the thickness L 0.050 squared. Let me pause. Let a few people calculate it. When you calculate it, let me have the number, please. You have it? All right. We're going to wait and see if we get some confirmations on that. One confirmation, thank you. 3.7623, thank you. Four, I'm going to get to 10. 5, 6, 7, 8. 9, 10. So hopefully everybody's able to get that Fourier number. Now that we confirm, oh yeah, it's greater than 0.2, we're going to use one term solution. Now we have to write that equation down. Okay, it's something like this. Theta asterisk, which was a ratio of two thetas, or maybe you want to write it like theta over theta initial is equal to the C1, the cosine of zeta 1 x hat, or x asterisk, times the exponential of minus zeta 1 squared Fourier number. So it's like we already calculated the Fourier number. We're interested in the surface, here's a key word, the surface temperature. What is x hat for the surface? X hat was the location x divided by L. X runs from 0 out this way. What is x hat at the surface? 1. It's equal to 1. Okay? So it's like we got the Fourier number, the dimensionless time. We got x hat or x asterisk, which is the dimensionless location. Okay. Let's do this one. Theta initial, we probably can get that one. Theta initial, right here. What is theta initial? T initial minus T infinity, negative 60 degrees C. And yes, if you're consistent, the negative sign will work itself out, no problem. Okay. Now, we want to get the zeta 1, which is here and here, as well as the C1. True? Okay, I'm going to pause, or maybe I shouldn't pause, or should I pause? Because you'll need your textbook. You'll need that table. the table 5.1. So maybe not in the interest of time, or in the interest of time, did you do the interpolation?
Yes.
Okay, give me your C1 first.
C1 is 1.0573.
All right, and then the zeta 1?
0.5891.
Let me pause. I know that probably somebody else can either double check it or look good. Give me a thumbs up if it looks good. It looks reasonable to me. Okay. So now it looks reasonable. So what's that surface temperature? So basically you're going to calculate theta is equal to negative 60 degrees C times C1, 1.0573, times the cosine of 0.5891 times 1, times the exponential of negative, then we put in 0.5891, but that we want to square it. Don't forget the square. And then we multiply by the Fourier number, 3.76. All of that is in our exponentials. Sorry about that, but that Fourier number probably is not very legible. 3.76 right there. What I'm going to do is I'm going to wait, and a few people are going to run that number. And I know it's going to be negative something. I'm just going to say this term is 0.27121. Okay, what is this? Should I have my calculator in degree mode or radian mode when I do the cosine of that number? Radians or degrees?
Radians.
All right, so that's error prone. Faculty love this type of error question on exams. So let's do that one. I got to switch mine. I'm sure my calculator is in degree mode. So now I need to change it. All right, so I pick up for this 0.83144. All right, then, and I pick up a negative 14.3, so that's at the surface, so this is equal to the temperature surface minus T infinity, so the temperature of the surface is equal to T infinity minus the 14.3. What is my surface temperature at 500 seconds? That's right. 45.7 degrees C. Does that look good? Thank you very much for your attention.